ॐ सहना भवतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः समस्तजनकल्याणी निरतं करुणामयम् नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरं ॐ पार्थाय प्रतिबोधितां भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथितां पुराणमुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनी अम्बत्वामनुसन्तदामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिनी यं ब्रह्मा वरुणेन्द्ररुद्रमरुतः स्तुन्वन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदैः साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषदैः गायन्ति यं सामगाः ध्यानावस्थिततद्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यं योगिनो यस्यान्तं न विदुः सुरा सुरगणाः देवाय तस्मै नमः देवाय तस्मै नमः We read from the 18th verse. विद्या विनय संपन्ने ब्राह्मणे गविहस्तिनी शुनि चैवश्वपाके च पंडिता समदर्शिनः इहैव तैर्जितः सर्गो येषां साम्ये स्थितं मनः निर्दोषं हि समं ब्रह्म तस्मात् ब्रह्मणि ते स्थिताः न प्रहृष्येत् प्रियं प्राप्य नोद्विजेत् प्राप्य चाप्रियं स्थिरबुद्धिरसं मूढः ब्रह्मविद् ब्रह्मणि स्थितः We saw in the previous session that the men of wisdom are those So the new parents who joined this year, these may join Mahadevji in the next level, second floor. So here we saw the men of wisdom are those of equal vision. Meaning, not that everybody looks the same, they are not. Their appearance is different, characteristics are different, faith is different, profession is different, language is different, and especially the Hindu community has variety. From east to west, north to south you go, you don't know whether they are, some of them are, whether human beings at all or not also. Meaning, different characteristics are there. You know, if you go to the wildest part of India, the tribal, it's hard to compare one person to another person. It happens in many of the countries. If you go to Australia also, the aborigines, they look so different from the city dwellers. If you go to the eastern part of India, the Mongolian influence is there, isn't it? Down south, it is more of African influence. Up north, it is more of Aryan influence. So you see the variety of people in terms of their physical characteristics or color of the skin or the kind of food that they eat, the language that they speak, the customs they follow, the gods they worship, variety is there. So when we say samadarshinaha, it does not mean that they look at all of them as same. Eyes definitely looks different things, different color, shapes and forms. So our sense organs are meant to experience differences. It is said in the Upanishad, Paranchikani Vidranat Swayambhu Tasmat Parang Pashyati Na Antaratman. The sense organs are designed to go outward, extrovert. So they always look the differences. Eyes, ears, nose, tongue, skin, all these faculties are meant to experience the variety. But in spite of the variety, there must be one underlying principle called life. Everyone is alive, whether not even human being, but also all other living beings, even the plant outside is alive. Birds, animals, insects, bacteria. So the question raised by the rishis, the saints of the past is, what is that common factor which is same in all, irrespective of the size of the being, living being, whether they are animate or inanimate, moving or unmoving, the trees and plants, they don't move but they are still alive. So that factor which is common in all must be the one which is origin. Sadeva Saumya Ida Amagra Asit. Upanishad clearly says that one which is the origin of the whole world must be something which must be positively existing. Because from unexistence or non-existence, existence cannot come. From nothing, everything can come. Can you say that? If there is everything, there must be something. Simple logic. So what is the nature of this reality which is the origin of everything? It must be of the nature of existence. Because all of us at all times feel and always we are aware of, I am. Isn't it? I exist. And nobody needs to prove that you are existence. Anybody needs to assure you that you exist? Do you ask anybody, do I really exist? Do you ever ask anybody that question? If you are asking that question, that person says, now are you talking then? The very fact that you are able to ask that question proves that you exist. So the nature of reality is existence. Second, I am aware of my existence. Not that I am unaware of my existence, I am aware of my existence. And constantly my pursuit has been to find happiness. So Sat, Chit, Anand. Existence, awareness and bliss. That is the nature of all of us. And that is the nature of God. So God is not a person, not is not a particular being. It is the very fact. That the very fact called Sat, Chit, Ananda, which we all experience all the time, but we tend to forget. A sadhu, a man of wisdom, does it. That's all the difference. I am, I know that I am, and I am of the nature of bliss. And not only me, everyone. They may not know. One may not know that. One may tend to forget, one may ignore it, or one may be busy with so many other things. And because of the forgetfulness of one's own blissful nature is what makes one unhappy actually. The unhappiness is not created by the world. The unhappiness is because of our forgetfulness of our nature. But the Mahatma, the self is, the saint is one who is constantly aware. Therefore, he doesn't depend upon the world to provide him joy. He would become a contributor of joy, not a slave or a seeker of joy. So, Samadarshinaha, when it is said, it is not that he doesn't see the colors, he doesn't see the forms and different shapes. No, he would see. But in and through that, he will see the presence of the one immaculate, everlasting, all-present, timeless, shape, formless, endless presence. Vidya vinaya sampanne brahmane gavihastini sunichaiva swapakecha panditaha samadarshinaha. And such people who have thus gained that complete mastery over that, iha eva taihi jitasarga yesham samyestitam manah. Yesham manah samyestitam, yesham manah samatvestitam. They always remain in the sameness, meaning that which is same in all. For such people, iha eva taihi sargah jitah. By them, the world is conquered. Why? The moment you conquered your mind, you've already conquered your world. Is it not true? What troubles us all the time is there a world outside without this mind? Tell me. 5 hours back, where was the world for you? Where was the world of your problems and confusions and likes and dislikes and ambitions and accomplishments and disappointments and rejections? Is there there? Was there? You are fast asleep. Why? The one which is subject to make you experience all these things was absent. Was not active, to be precise. Mind. And then when the alarm came, you alarmed yourself to the world. When the mind has come up, the world has come up. Manohya vidya bhavabandha heduhu tasmin vinashte sakalam vinashtam vijrumbade asmin sakalam vijrumbade. When the mind is not there, the world of all these varieties of his concerns and the problems are also not there. Now, can we then they say that, okay, Swamiji, that is the reason why we become spiritual. Once we take that, the mind is no more a trouble. It's a trouble for others, not for us. Isn't it? Chal mere bhai. Goes and holds on to the pillar around. My dear uncle, where were you all this time? So, forgetting the mind or letting go of the mind or suppressing the mind may be a temporary solution. Saturday afternoon basketball game. Same thing. Why do we all do all these things? To get rid of this mind, troubling mind. When the movie is over or the TV program is over, again it starts. Tomorrow you have to go to work. I'm reminding you. Now you are sitting comfortably there. You're trying to forget that. So all the things, preoccupations and entertainment and vacation, all that we do is to get rid of this fellow for time being. Sleep is the best way to do that. But again, wake up, again it's there. So long as the mind is there, mind is not under your control, the world will trouble you. So instead of setting right the world in order, that is what the extrovert materialistic world will do. Comfortable home, comfortable house, comfortable conveniences. All these are all to make sure that external world which we deal with is not troublesome. Whatever the new equipments that we have got to use and then easy to cook and easy to do all these things and easy to travel from one place to another, easy to communicate, all these things, possible external troubles which can be caused by the inefficiency of the system is overcome by the science to make the world comfortable for us to live. But if you are troubled by anger, lust, passion, greed, jealousy, how can the science will help you in that? Maybe at the maximum, take a pill. Medical drugs. What do you call that? Marijuana. Medical drugs. I give some extra, some what do you call it, adjective to it, but this quality doesn't change. So therefore, hiha eva taihi jitas sargaha yesham manaha samye sthitam. When the mind has recognized the oneness in all, what causes the troubles and sorrows and agitations and unhappiness and dejection and depression is because we are not seeing the one. We are seeing the variety. Due to seeing the variety, we either have likes about it or dislikes about it. And these likes and dislikes cause the trouble. Expectation and disappointments. You expect and doesn't happen, disappointment. So, nirdosham hi samam brahma. Understand nirdosham, defectless, changeless, same, is the nature of that reality, brahma. Tasma brahmani te sthitaha. Therefore, they ever abide in that state of oneness. That's again, I had to reiterate this point, that this oneness is not due to the oneness of religion, oneness of culture, oneness of language, oneness of anything other than that one which is always one. Any other change that you bring in, it's temporary. You cannot have a universal religion. Everybody follow the same thing. Doesn't happen. Everybody speak the same language, it's not going to happen. Everybody eat the same food, it's not going to happen. Everybody wear the same dress, not going to happen. But everybody is same. That you realize. Essentially, we are all of the same nature, expressing it in different ways. Just like one electricity expressing it in different ways, according to the equipments in which through which it is expressing. So therefore, iha eva taihi jitaha sargaha yesham samye sthitam manaha nirdosham hi samam brahma tasmat brahmani te sthitaha te brahmani sthitaha. They remain in constant awareness of this. So it is not an external practice. That's what we need to realize. Spirituality is not an external practice. It is not the religion you belong or the god you worship or the mantra you utter or the rituals that you perform. None of these really make any change in the understanding, or the understanding does not make any change outside, really speaking. You continue to do what you are doing. Swami Vivekananda is a great visionary, the forerunner of Hinduism of the recent times, whose birthday we, January 12th it was. He had related a story, very beautiful story. He said, A king was visited by a saint, and that saint was giving satsangs and talks, and then the king went to him and said, Maharaj, I have to ask you one thing. Yes. When do I take to renunciation, sannyas? You should bless me with that. So the saint asked him this question, why do you need to take sannyas? No, I want to find ultimate joy, moksha. I want salvation, I want liberation, I want freedom, I want joy, ultimate joy. So the saint looked at him, for that you don't need to take up to sannyas. Wherever you are, continue to do, change your attitude. So he said, that is not practical. I am a king and I have so many responsibilities, I don't think it will ever end unless I quit. He said, I'll have to take you somewhere. Please come with me. But disguise yourself as a common man. Is it okay? So he changed himself to become ordinary person. So they both went. Where are you taking me? He said, I'll take you to the country, next country, or next desha, another region. Come with me. When they went there, in that kingdom, there was a swayamvara that was going on. Meaning, the princess was to get married, and she has to choose the right person. Assembled were there many, many different people, those who were ready to marry her, so many different kings and others were all assembled. And all other general people also, just to watch this. It's like our basketball game or something. There are so many people assembled. Watch this beautiful event. Because it's a big event, a princess is choosing her, you know, husband. So they're all standing there. So the girl, very beautiful she was, she came with her garland in her hand, trying to choose the right person. Just looking around. Suddenly she found one person in the crowd who was a very young sadhu, sannyas, a renunciate. He was also in the crowd. She went around and put it on his neck. That fellow was alarmed. He came as a witness, and he was a renunciate, he is a monk, and he saw the garland is on his, he started running from there. He ran, literally, and she was chasing him. So these two fellows, the king and the saint, also they ran behind, you know, just to wonder what is going to happen. That fellow ran, and he disappeared. So the lady, this doctor, this, this princess, she got so upset and she was crying. And then eventually she went back. And these two of them, the king and the saint, they further walked and they found that young sannyasi was sitting under a tree. Thank God, I saved myself. He said, and remove the garden, and, garland and put it down there. It was cold evening, and they were shivering at that time. They did not know what to do, because they didn't find any source of any kind of food ever available to them. So they gathered some twigs and wood pieces there, put them together, and at least to heat up the place. So they were ready to they were putting it there to warm up. While they were doing that, on the tree there were three does, birds, mother, father and the son. They were there looking at them, and they thought that these people are hungry and not anything to eat. Let us become their food. They directly fell themselves onto the fire. One of them fell, the father, the mother and the son, they did not fall, they stood next to that fire, looking up to them. So the sadhu looked at it and said to the king, this is what I meant. So the king did not understand, what do you mean? I asked you something else is happening, what is the connection here? He said, see, this monk, he knew that he is a monk. And therefore, even the most attractive girl that came, with the kingdom she came, did he have a desire for that? He didn't have the desire for that. Therefore, even as she came and placed the garland on his neck, and he would become eligible to become the king as well, but he said, no, I'm not, because I know what I am. So he left her. Is it not? Yes. These birds, look at them. They are householders. They are living as a family. Yet they are ready to sacrifice themselves for our good, for our survival. It does not matter whether you are a householder or a king, or as a renunciate. You do your thing, ready to sacrifice yourself for the better good, betterment of yourself. That is what is really a real spiritual growth. Be aware what who you are. Be ready to serve others. Be aware of what your prime responsibility in life is. So, it is not necessary that we have to run away from our given responsibilities to find something else. In fulfilling our own responsibility with the dedication of offering, the being aware of why I am here, that is what is making you really move forward and not anything else. So when a person realizes that I don't need to change my job, I don't need to change what I do, I don't need to go somewhere else, because what I'm seeking is already there, hidden in me. I am not paying attention to that. That's what making me miserable. If I ignore, obviously, nobody else is responsible for that. I'm not paying attention to my own reality. So here, therefore, such an individual who has thus gained a mastery over his own self, having recognized his essence, external world, whether it brings something joyful or painful, na prahrishchet priyam prapya, na udvijet prapya cha apriyam, sthira buddhihi asammoodaha brahmavit brahmanisthidaha. Priyam prapya na prahrishchet, when the world offers him laurels and honors and respects and pleasures, he is not affected by that, he is not elated, he is not excited about it. Na udvijet, neither he becomes disturbed. Prapya cha apriyam, when undesirable things come to him, he is not going to be affected by that either. Why? Sthira buddhihi, steady mind. We need the mind to operate in this world. We don't need the mind when you do meditation. But it is something which we may be able to have a mastery over. It's like when you are walking out of this room, of the program is over, you switch off the light because you don't need it. Isn't it? Some people don't do it. That's a different thing. When I come in the late in the afternoon, say everything is on, the AC was on, switch it off. Because nobody is there, why it is running? So in the same way, when the mind is necessary, we use it, operate it in this world. But when we don't need it, we know how to switch it off. So when your children also watching TV in the late evening, and then when you go home, they are fast asleep. We still don't you get mad? What do you mean? Don't you know that when you're not watching, switch it off? If the boy has already learned Balvihar, he would say, Daddy, when you don't need a mind, will you switch it off? Forcefully we switch it off when we go to sleep, obviously. It is not you switch it off, it switches off itself. But do you have the ability to switch it off? Whenever you don't want? Especially when your wife is complaining, you switch it off. That you do. But do you switch off your mind to yourself? I don't need the mind anymore for some time. That's meditation. But we don't have that. A person who is capable of doing that, ability to switch on when he wants and switch it off when he doesn't want, is a person who could meet the world irrespective of how it presents itself. If it is something which is making one joyful, one doesn't lose balance in becoming too excited about it, nor when it is insulting, disrespectful, he will get agitated. I was just last week we had this Ramayana sessions there, very clearly when the whole country was in jubilance, they were celebrating because Sri Rama is going to get coronated. As he walked into the chamber of Dasharatha, Dasharatha could not speak a word because of the overwhelming pain he went through listening to Kaikeyi. But Kaikeyi clearly narrates to him saying that you have to get out of this place today itself to the forest for 14 years. Wearing only a matterlock and bark of a tree, get out. And Bharata in your place will get to coronate today. No change in his face. He looks at, that's how? Definitely he will do it. The face of Rama was unmoving. Not that he became a stone-like existence, he knew. I'm not going to be excited over either this coronation that is going to happen where I would become a king, nor for 14 years of stay in the lonely forest all by myself. At that time he was not ready, he was not even thinking of taking Sita and Lakshmana anyway. Okay, let it come, I will face it. That integrity, that's what is called sthira buddhi, asammooda, undeluded. Why? Brahmavit. He, the one who knows his own nature. As I am that Sat, pure existence, Chit, awareful of my existence, Anand, of the nature of bliss, nothing of the world can touch that. Nirdosham hi samam Brahma. So therefore, Brahmavit, knower of that Brahman, Brahmani in that Sthita. He has stayed put there. So, it is not something which suddenly happens. It cannot. Because of our intellectual understanding, it is not going to happen. Don't think, oh, now I know Brahman. Therefore, I am. No. It takes lives together. Not even days or months. Lives. Bahunam janmanam ante, Krishna says, after many, many lives, if you continuously strive towards that, you may probably. Now, when it is said that he does not get affected by the external situations, what does it mean? Arjuna, I mean Sri Krishna himself explains, because as Guruji also mentioned, when he says something, he explains it to himself. Now, you see the next verse, he explains what does he mean by untouched by the external world. Bahya sparsheshva sattatma vindatyatmani yatsukam sabrahma yoga yuktatma sukamakshayam ashnute bahya sparsheshva sattatma vindatyatmani yatsukam sabrahma yoga yuktatma sukamakshayam ashnute. I was watching Swami Guru Chinmayananda Gurudev's chapter 6 talks yesterday. We are going to show it next year, next month for all of us. When the Jyoti is going to be here, you will see that. So in that he was explaining, you know, how unless we attach ourselves to something, detachment does not happen. About the world. You are standing on the floor, and if you want to detach from the world, what you should do? Jump. When you jump, you may detach from the floor for a short time, but again you will come back, isn't it? That's what we do. First day of January, I gave up, Swami. What did you give up? I gave up smoking. When? Yesterday. Right. I'll meet you after 2 days. You'll come back only. Why? Because you can jump, but if you are not holding on to something which can take you away from it, you'll come back. If you have a rod that is running on that above, and you jump and pick it up, then, but you can be away from the floor, you're feet will be above the floor. Why? You are attached. Isn't it? Unless you attach yourself to something, real detachment from the world of vicissitudes would not happen. Another example. You might have seen the children, young children, small ones, they pick up something which is very valuable to you and they will not give it to you. Especially if you have a Rolex watch. That fellow somehow caught hold of it, picked it. And he does not know what to do with that. He is looking at it and putting it like this. And he says, oh my God, hey, they give me. Yeah, that fellow won't give because it's strong. Oh, now what do we do that? Because this fellow will break that thing into pieces. Because he has no idea what it is. And then he puts it in the mouth and nothing happens. So what you do is, you take a chocolate. You see this? Chocolate! That fellow looks with bright eyes. Because the chocolate is more valuable to him than the Rolex watch. In his world, the chocolate is much more valuable than anything else in the world. The moment he looks at the chocolate, and that you peel it off and show him that. So that fellow is so excited. When he gets excited, whatever he has in his hand, he will just throw it. So you be careful. hold your hand, the other hand, and show that. So that one, he drops it, picks up the chip. He says, the moment you give him a chocolate, you take the Rolex box and run. Don't stay there. Because after finishing the chocolate, again you look for the Rolex watch. So unless there is the attachment to something higher, the attachment to the lower level of our experiences and the pleasures will not go away. So unless we have this attachment to the higher very clearly, our preoccupation in the world, which decides our joy, will not stop. Therefore, it is said, yat atmani sukam vindati, yat sukam atmani vindati, yat sukam, that joy, atmani in the higher self, vindati discovers, who bahya sparsheshu asakta atma, bahya sparsheshu, in external contact, sparsha contact, bahya sparsheshu, in the external contact, asakta atma, not attached. Why? He had found a greater joy there, then why should he in this? At the present moment, we do not even attempt to do that. We don't even know that the greater joy is there within us. And therefore, we are, everybody is occupied with the world outside, therefore, we just imitate. We are monkeys only. We just imitate what others do. Oh, my neighbor had, therefore I should have. My neighbor is going for vacation, I should also go. My sister-in-law is going for this, I have to go there. She bought it, I have to buy it. Many people buy things because they, not that they want it, because somebody else bought it. My friend bought it, therefore it, I should also have it. Most of us do that. You are sending your children to Bal Vihar, I also want to go. Right? You come because your children were children, not because your friend went there. So, bahya sparsheshu, in external contacts, asakta atma, detached, how? Yad sukam atmani vindade. Where he has slowly discovered a greater joy within oneself, the interest in external arrangement of things that can bring a temporary joy is less and less. Sa brahma yoga yukta atma. Brahma yoga yukta atma. The very word is beautiful. Brahma yoga. Association or being in touch with the Brahman. In that yukta atma. Ever present, ever practicing. Such an individual. Sukham akshayam ashnude. And what kind of a joy he will thus discover. Akshayam sukham. Undiminishing. Everlasting. So these kind of words are used, everlasting, undiminishing, eternal. Unless we reach there, you definitely would not know that. However much flowery words these scriptures can, in which they explain, unless we ourselves attempt on it, it is just a word. You know, if you have never been to Niagara Falls and somebody, you ask somebody, "How? What is this Niagara Falls?" You never been? Huge collection of water coming down with such a force. Oh. You have, you cannot imagine, however much you can imagine, unless you are there only, you really want to know what it is. Even if you are seeing IMAX theater, Niagara Falls, or Everest, and you cannot feel the cold by looking at the movie, can you? Some people ask, Swamiji, are you taking people to Kailash? Yes. How cold it is? -2. Evening, night, day. How -2? Oh, I have been in Chicago, I know what is -2. That -2 is not this -2, I'm telling you. It is a chilling, piercing -2 it is. Why it is so, Swamiji? Because there is no heater. Anywhere. Only heat that you can have is your body heat. That's all it is. So, however much anybody would explain, it is only a theoretical intellectual appreciation. But when you are there, that experience is there for, it's not a book. It's edo vacho nivartanti aprapya manasa. So, words will come back along with the mind not reaching there. So, akshayam sukham, when it is said, it is undiminishing, imperishable joy that a person will experience. It's presently, it is only paroksha. It's only vicarious. But is it not true? Just our day-to-day example also, at the end of a tiring day, exhausting day, when you hit the bed, what a joy. I finished all my work and whatever I need to do tomorrow. So when you relax at the end of a very tiring day, at the joy that you get, who gives? Who is giving you that joy? Bed. Bed is not giving you, because next to you, your husband, turning and twisting around. He is not able, because Monday he has to submit a project. He has not even done anything to it. So the bed is not giving the joy. Now that's why you have to sleep at the number bed. What is that called? Sleep number. Your number is different from her number. Whatever it is. But the bed is not giving that joy. If your mind is disturbed, what bed, whatever be the bed, you cannot sleep. So that joy that you experience in relaxing moments of your night is because you have completed the job and then your physical body is tired, and then even the joy that you get during the sleep is not externally conditioned. Much less is the joy that he has discovered with himself. That joy is much greater. That joy is not dictated by the world outside. So, bahya sparsheshu, in outside context, asakta, unattached. How is it? Because yat atmani sukham bindati. When he has gained a greater attention and alertness and awareness about one's own self happiness. See, this does not mean he does not want to deal with others. It's not like that. Don't think that way. Asakta does not mean disinterested. He is above it. It is there, but I don't demand it. If it is not there, I am not going to be depressed about it. That kind of an attitude. If it is there, it is okay. If it is not there, I am not going to be disturbed by that. So he is there, but at the same time, not controlled by it. Gurudev used to say, when you gain this kind of an ability to meet the world without demanding anything from it, even if your wife does not put salt, you will still eat without complaining. And she will be surprised. I didn't put salt at all, you are still eating. Doesn't matter. After all, food. Salt or no salt, doesn't matter. This is the effect of going to Gita class. I'm also coming. See, you have become a marketing person. So, the ability to rise above, you may add salt, but that doesn't mean that without the salt you will sit and cry and complain and shout about. Doesn't matter. If you shout about, she has only one simple answer for that. Put the salt yourself. I don't know how much you want. Why unnecessarily go to that? You quietly put, take salt and put. So, the ability to face the world without complaining, not getting disturbed by what is around. That's what it means. Asaktatma means. Not that he runs away from it. Bahya sparsheshu, in the objects and emotion and thoughts, that is created by apparently the world outside. As you come in contact with the world, through the body you perceive the object, through the mind you feel the emotions, through the intellect you think the thoughts. This perceiver, feeler, thinker, which is the ego here, which is the one which is getting disturbed all the time, because it takes this contact to be too serious. Body contacting, perceiving the object, it takes too seriously. Mind feeling the emotions, it takes too seriously. Intellect thinking the thoughts, it takes it too seriously. Because it is so occupied due to the power of vasanas, it has failed to remain in the higher self. So when a person is able to let go of the perceiver, feeler, thinker in him, in spite of being in touch with the objects, emotional thoughts, as you slowly detach yourself from yourself, from your own lower self, from your own egoistic self. And that detachment is possible only when there is something to attach to. So it's like, you know, might have seen the caterpillar, it will not move unless it has found the next leaf. Once it has found the next leaf, it will leave the other one. That's why it's called leave. Leave. You leave to go to another one, and that also to be left, go to the next one. Then the same way, unless you have attained the greater control over your own self, your own inner happiness, leaving the world is not that easy. Leaving the world means not getting affected by the world is not easy. By just physically relinquishing the world does not mean you have found the joy. This is not going to happen. Don't put the cart before the horse. Let me leave the world, then find the happiness. Where? How do you go to sleep? Not switch off suddenly, right? Slowly. You close your eyes. I don't want to see anything. Switch off the light. Because the light is so bright and then it doesn't make me sleep. Switch off. Draw the curtain. Put the rug. Then your wife is complaining about you or somewhere. Slowly. I don't want to listen to her. So ears you cannot close. She will open and talk. So you withdraw your withdraw your attention from your ears. Withdraw your mind from away from the ears. Isn't that you are withdrawing your mind from things? Ears are open only, nose is open only. Sometimes mouth is open only, it's sleeping. But what is getting withdrawn is not the senses. Not the world is going away. You withdraw your mind away from it. In the same way, just like a person who is interested to sleep withdraws his own mind consciously or unconsciously, in the same way, let the world be what it is. I am not interested. Let it present it itself, pleasant or unpleasant. I am not going to be disturbed by that. Bahya sparsheshu asaktatma vindati vindatyatmani yat sukam sa brahma yoga yuktatma sukam akshayam ashnuti. Undiminishing, imperishable, everlasting, eternal, continuous, consistent joy. In fact, even the joy that we derive in this world actually is coming from there only. We don't know that. When you get what you want, it is not because that object is giving that joy, really speaking. Because the demanding mind is quiet. The demanding mind, I want, I want, I want, I want, I want, I want. Just like morning coffee, 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 coffee. The moment you give coffee, one first sip, over. You don't even take the whole coffee also. Or cigarette also. First of all. And that fellow is still burning there. That demanding mind that I want that cigarette. That mind has been appeased by the first, what do you call it? What do you take that? First sip or puff? First puff, okay. I have not done it, so I don't know. First puff. It's over. Afterwards it's not disturbed. Why? Because the mind that is demanding this is given what it wants. Then it will have some, why not about coffee? So when the mind has been trained to withdraw, not forcefully, but able to find something greater. Now, we are not able to do that because our training has been, constantly we have been trained to find joy only in the world outside. And nobody has in the school or anywhere else told that a greater joy is within you. Nobody told them. Neither in the school, nor in the university, nor in the neighborhood, in your own parents, none of them. Everybody is so busy with the world, and therefore our mind has been programmed constantly to keep looking for things outside for pleasure. Only when you start thinking, really is there joy there? Or I am assuming it to be there? It's a software problem. You have been programmed that way, that it is joy, it is joy. And you look at the advertisement, it's also like that only. Papa John's pizza, or whatever it is. What touch? So we think that tea must be good. If you drink the tea, I will also be happy. Programmed. I watch. You keep watching. So you have to, all these things are given to you, programming you to think the way they want you to think. So here Krishna says, if you really go deeper and to find out, is it really joyful? And you will find what? See the next verse. Yehi samsparsha ja bhogaha. Dukkayonaya evate. Adyantavanta kaunteya. Nate shuramate buddha. Yehi samsparsha ja bhogaha. Dukkayonaya evate. Adyantavanta kaunteya. Nate shuramate buddha. Any sense or touch-born experience, pleasure, joy, anything that is experienced as joy due to contact, samsparshaja bhogaha, pleasures that are born out of contact, dukkha yone, they are subject to, they are wombs of sorrow. See, this is not a dark picture he is trying to put there. Not like in the Buddhism says, sarvam, shanikam, shanikam, sarvam, dukkam, dukkam. It's not that. It's not that the whole world is nothing but the pain, nothing but sorrow. No, that is not the conclusion here. They are potentially giving you sorrow. Potential. Not they are sorrowful, but they have the potentiality, they have the potency to give you sorrow. When? You overindulge there. It is not the world to be shunned, saying that it is full of pain. No. And why it is then it is painful, if at all? Adi anta vanta. Because we have beginning and then end. Any sense contact born experience has to begin sometime. And anything that has begun must end at some point of time. Began, today has begun, Sunday morning. And the morning of Sunday when you got up, whole day I have absolutely nothing to do. Let us say, no, your wife has got already a list of things. But you say, no, I am not going to do anything. Give me a break. Today I am not going to do. Balvihar, that time may come. Don't ask me to do anything else. Relax. How long? Somewhere up to the 10:30. After the barbier is over, it looms large that the day is going to come to an end. Yeah. As it goes closer to the end, Monday. That's what in this part of the world they say, pink slip Monday. Right? You don't know what is going to happen on Monday. The share market will go boom down. You don't know. So, anything that has begun must end. So, any pleasure that has been derived due to contact, due to association, must have an end. That is the pain he is talking about. The uncertainty, the impermanency, the temporary nature, evanescent, transparent, transient. That transiency, that evanescence, that impermanence is the pain, and not by themselves. It's not going to last long. Start of a vacation, you're joyful. Middle of the vacation, you're concerned. End of the vacation, again. Well, going to India, you're so excited. Isn't that true? No jet lag. Come back. 3-4 days over. 1 week over. Why? Because there's no excitement. Back same home. But those people come here, they don't have jet lag. They enjoy. And if they go back, jet lag. Why? Because the excitement. Disneyland, Universal, that did this. So in the beginning, everything is so excited, and like marriages also. Somewhere in the middle age, I think I made a mistake. Even before also you have realized about it, but now you are confirming it. Definitely it's a mistake. So towards the end, completely detached. Do whatever you want. When the child is born, it's so excitement. Afterwards, sit down. That fellow wonders, when I never talked, he wanted me to talk. Now you, they don't want me to talk. When I was not walking, they went, walk, run. And now I'm running, just stand in one place. Running all the time. So everything in the beginning, yes, but in Adi Ant, it has an end. So because of that impermanence, Adyantavanta Kaunteya, they Kaunti Kunti San, understand one thing, the Dukkham is not because its nature is Dukkha, Dukkham. It is because of its uncertainty, impermanence, temporariness. Potentially it has to end. So, ehi samsparshaja bhoga, all contact-born blushes are dukkha yonaya evate. They are. See, for that matter, the sadhus and sant mahatmas are also living in the same world where you and I live. They also contact the same world, which they also eat the same kind of food. Not special anything coming there for them. It's not that the Lord is bringing special food for them. Same. But their ability to let go of any joy, when it is rising there itself, then no, this is, yes, I may experience, but not going to last long. Even this will pass away. Everything is there for a short time. And after some time, it's not going to be there. Be ready for that. Not becoming pessimistic about that. Not becoming negative about it. But being practical. That's why it is said, Vedanta is neither pessimistic nor optimistic. It is realistic. Let us look at the fact squarely and say, yes, it is there. After some time, it's not going to be there. Be aware. So, Adi Antavanta, beginning and end they have, he Kaunteya, na Buddha teshu ramate, men of wisdom, they don't get too much got involved in that. They don't indulge in that. Ramanam is to enjoy, indulge. Na teshu ramate, they don't. They don't does not mean that they, again, please don't take it to the other extreme of running away, shunning it, no. They are aware and they carefully deal with that. This ability to remain in balance, the ability to become so realistic about the worldly pleasures and pain is also the same. The pain also, it has a beginning and an end. When you are lost somebody very dear or closer, you may have that experience of pain. After some time, slowly fades away. Then you are occupied with something else. Is it not that you look around, you know, many people whom you know, you have been with, they're not there now, either they are gone or they are away somewhere else. So, you know that they are, everybody is existing in this world, sometime we are coming closer and then getting attached and all this, after some time. Every one of us have come individually. Is it not true? Your husband did not come with you, thank God. Your wife did not come with you. Your children also did not come along with you. they came. They'll be there. They will have to find their ways. It's like, you know, beautifully put, the logs of wood that has come in the river flowing, and they come together sometime and then drift away to different places and then they move about. Because according to their each one's karma action, they will do whatever they need to do. So this thinking, contemplation, dwelling deeper reveals to us that my journey is what I have to undertake. Others may come and join me and we may go together, but no dependence on because of me alone, him alone, I am surviving, but because of me alone, somebody else is surviving. Let us be realistic about it. So long as we have the company of people or help each other, enjoy the company, no doubt, but be aware. Adyantavanta Kaunteya. Beginning and end is there. Nati Ishwaramati Budaha. Men of wisdom don't get indulged in that. So this understanding is what Krishna wants us to get into. And not only it is an intellectual understanding, let us put it in our practical life as well. Then only we find a solution to our problem. As we have been seeing, the problem is not the world has presented itself in front of you. The problem is exaggerated in the mind because it is incapable of dwelling deeper. It is not ready to think. Without drinking water, you may can stay for 2-3 hours. Without drinking food, eating food, you can stay for 4-5 hours. Without thinking, people live forever. That's the problem. Think. Don't just, you know, every day is the same, to do the same thing over and over and again. That doesn't change anybody. Thinking alone changes the person. Why do you send your children to school? Think. Is it not that? They go and come back every day and then what did you learn? Nothing. But the very going to the educational, to the school is to develop the way of thinking. The thinking is not developed, just going and writing exam and coming back, and that is not. So in our life also, the problem is the children grow, parents never. We also have to slowly develop our way of thinking and then our ways of thinking, not only what you think, but how you think. Only then we see the improvement. Otherwise, we'll be still the same. Angry for the same thing and lusty for the same thing. And so if that is continuing, then one should start asking this question. Have I improved in my thinking? Furthermore, we'll see in the next session, Sri Krishna has more pointers to give for our own practical application. And this particular chapter ends in contemplation leading to meditation. That is the next chapter, 6th chapter. It's about how to literally sit down and practice it. It's not just intellectual understanding, but put it in a practical use in everyday life. Concretize your understanding. So that we will be also be seeing 6th chapter, and as I said, towards the last week of February, we will have one whole week of Jnana Yajna talks by Swami Chinmayananda. 1.5 hour talk every day in the evening from 7 to 8:30. From 20th February, please mark your calendar now. I am sitting almost a month before, I am telling you, more than a month before. 20th of February to 26th of February. There will be daily talks on meditation. And on the 27th, which is Saturday, we will have a workshop on meditation. So where we will see the practically how to sit down and do it. And that is open to all. That will be the last part of our Chinmay Jyoti Yatra here. And 28th, we will take the Jyoti to San Diego. So I will talk about it a little later. Om Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinah, Sarve Santu Niramayah, सर्वे भद्राणि पश्यन्तु मा कश्चित् दुःखभाग् भवेत्। ओम शांति शांति शांति। हरि ओम। श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः। हरि ओम।